Welcome to the Palm Developer Day. I'm Ben.
And I'm Dion, and we were recently directors of developer relations. And you know, when we left, we talked about we still want to be involved in the community, and people were like, yeah, they just said that. And we just want to say thanks to HP for like giving us the opportunity to stay involved, as you can see from us being here today.
And we'll talk more about what we're up to now in just a few minutes. Before we get into the talk, we do have a few housekeeping notes we wanted to go through with you. First of all, we sent out surveys yesterday and to your email, and we really want you to fill those surveys out. They're infinitely valuable to us to help us make the Developer Day as great as we can make it. So if you haven't filled out your survey yet, please do. And we'll have another survey at the end of today, so watch for that.
Then we've got the wireless network. If you're having any issues at all, there's a couple of nice chaps in the back over here who can help you get set up.
Those IT two guys, right there.
There they are, right
if you have any computer problem whatsoever, in fact.
Yeah, got some viruses. Got some viruses, just head on over.
The phone's not working right, just those two, right
yes.
there.
Yes.
And then tonight we've got a party at Lucky Strike. Now, it's not close by to this venue, but it's such an incredible party venue that we thought it was worth the trip. We've got a bus service that'll take you up there, and those will start later on tonight. So please make it out. It starts at 6 o'clock, and we've got a lot of fun stuff planned there, so you'll definitely want to check it out.
So let's get some of the fun stuff out of the way to begin with, right? We talked about how we're going to raffle off some devices.
So Palm Pre 2s. We've got a supply of Palm Pre 2s here, limited supply, and a few people are going to get those devices. And the way you find out...
Yeah, how should we do it? Should we get a... Well, how about if we do the Oprah thing and like look under your seat, and if you find...
So if there's a piece of paper under your seat, some kind of a Post-it, then that means you've won a Palm Pre 2.
Oh, looks like a lot of people have got them. Someone screwed up. Oh, no. Yes, indeed. So it's not open for you to get it yet because we want to make sure you stay here and actually listen to us. Chat about a few things, but as soon as we're done, then you can collect your...
So maybe we went a little crazy with the Post-it notes, but if you don't have a chair, don't worry about it. We can get you sorted out, but I think everyone has a chair. And don't go to the empty chair next to you, just one device per person. Okay. And that's my chair. That's my chair.
Yeah.
And the last thing we wanted to tell you about is this thing called the App Lab that's running concurrently with all the presentations today. So if you have any issues at all with webOS development, if you have any questions you need answered, if you're having life problems of any kind, just head over to the App Lab. We've got staff that can walk you through it and help you. And we're going to have some of our core webOS engineers as well as our developer relations people in the App Lab, so check that out.
Cool. Should we get going?
I think so.
I think we should tell a bit of a story this morning, kind of talk about what's going on kind of with the state of the web and kind of the industry in general before we have some great keynote speakers to come on after us. But to kind of tell this story, we thought we'd kind of talk a little bit about Microsoft.
Well, you just ruined the punchline. You just ruined the punchline. So what we were going to do... We have these quotes, and we thought this is pretty interesting, actually. If you look at three recent quotes that Microsoft said about HTML5. With HTML5, you can make an experience as rich as an app. HTML5 is a beautiful thing, and HTML5 makes desktop operating system SDKs obsolete. And this was said at the recent IE9 beta event. And we were just amazed when this happened, because, well, first of all, one of these quotes, this one we actually made up. They didn't actually say this one.
Yeah.
But the other quotes.
Yeah. Trust us on the others. Trust us on the others. You gotta have three, you know. You
gotta have three. Good things happen in threes. The other quotes were really shocking to us at the time, and in fact, in the context of it, it's even a little bit more interesting. They had this massive event that was really, really well produced. I mean, you may think that we pull out the stops for this one, but it was an amazing event.
Yeah, and this was just a beta. This was like the first beta of the product.
Not even the final beta.
Exactly, yeah, and they held it down the road from Adobe, kind of like in their face a little bit, kind of talking about all of the amazing experiences that you can build on the web. And this is coming from Microsoft. I'm not talking about Silverlight. This is all just web stuff that they're showing off. They had a whole A to Z of all these amazing experiences that you can use using web standards.
And you know, for us, Microsoft has long been the devil that we knew and understood. Like, we understand what motivates them. We understand how their business is based. It's based on the Windows and Office franchises. And their reaction to the web in the past has been stuff like Silverlight. And so for them to embrace HTML5, we just thought, wow, what a sudden shift. And we really were curious what caused this shift. And so we wanted to explore this for a couple of minutes in this morning's talk about why that happened, because we think the reasons behind their embrace of HTML5 contain relevant lessons for all of us. And so our story sort of starts a few years in the past.
I bet those IT guys remember this. You know? We've all been there. But what was the web like back in those days? Not the most beautiful. This is Apple's site, known for nice design. Yahoo. Disney, not particularly rich.
Pretty much looks the same, actually.
kind of the same.
But Microsoft's reaction, even when the web was sort of pitiful, was to acknowledge its potential and to really try and contain it. And I think this quote from Jim Clark sort of describes that. And the strategy was to bundle Internet Explorer with Windows, and it was to cause this sort of Windows lock-in with ActiveX, and to raise user expectations through technologies like Windows Presentation Foundation to make users want things that the web couldn't deliver. But if you look at the broader context at the time, there were a lot of interesting things happening. In addition to WPF, there were other technologies that were raising user expectations. The tech economy was going through a bit of a recession at the time, and Java, which had been the de facto standard for building web experiences, had matured. It got kind of boring. And I don't know, I'm sure you guys don't fit into this category, but some technologists kind of get bored when technologies mature and start to sort of poke around for other things, even though they could be very productive with the mature technology. And technologies like Ruby were causing people to reevaluate how they built web experiences. And so into this context came the Ajax movement, which really revolutionized how we did web stuff. But it was more than just technology. If you look at dictionary.com, it had this really boring static design for a long time. And when Ajax hit, it was interesting. They just started to reinvest in their design. And we see this across all the properties on the web.
Yeah, so if we go back to the examples we saw before, something like Yahoo looks, you know, a lot richer now. Of course, Apple itself looks, you know, typical Apple, nice and clean and white. Disney is very, very rich, using a lot of Flash. Etc. Google, again, kind of changed not that much, but you know, the logo's a lot nicer. It's just really, they polished that logo.
Yeah, I guess it's a little different.
Yeah. And then this is the calendar application that I used to use back
Actually,
in the day.
Looking at the date, I think you still use this, right?
Well, it's a bit of a dirty secret. You know, I've got real taste for design, and you compare that to like Mobile Me, it's just an utterly different experience. And so a lot of things have changed, and now we're at a point where we can deliver these fantastic experiences, and we have great sites like Smashing Magazine and others that are kind of talking to us about what you can do with design.
So as the web experienced rebirth, Microsoft's reaction, as we mentioned before, was Silverlight to pull people from the web, and also these sort of, you know, underwhelming browser releases, IE7 and IE8. And at the same time, the web community banded together to take things to the next level. Ajax was about sort of figuring out how to extract more from what we had, and the What Working Group and other groups of practitioners and browser manufacturers and others got together to try and push things further. And in fact, if you go back to the way things were when Ajax first hit, there were a lot of problems with the web as a platform. But today,
we get HTML5, right? And this is what the marketing folk like to think HTML5 is. We can. Yes, indeed, unicorns. It's beautiful, solves every problem. But what is HTML5? Well, a lot of people like to talk about the spec, and there's the kind of spec weenies that go out there and say, no, it's just the things that are in this one document. But we kind of consider HTML5 and friends, all of the great new technology that you can use today to deliver these really rich applications. Right. With Ajax, we added just a couple of things that could allow us to just do remote calls, so you don't have to refresh the page. But now we've got things that you're more used to in kind of a richer stack to deliver these things.
So really, in our view, HTML5, when people use that word, they're not talking about the spec. They're talking about really everything that's happened since HTML4. And it's important to keep this in mind, because This is really what people have in mind whenever they mention it. Occasionally we see people who like want to create amazing applications with HTML5 and they go to a literal HTML5 workshop and they're taught like semantic tags and the differences between divs and headers and they're very confused. And this is one of the reasons why. And we think this starts to explain the reason why now Microsoft has made such a rapid embrace of HTML5, because the web is now different than it has been for virtually ever since it was introduced. The web is now a really fantastic application platform. But we think there's a little bit more to the story than just that.
Yeah, we also see that there's another big change happening, which is kind of for the first time we've got this merge of desktop and browsers with mobile itself. These kind of ecosystems are coming together. WebOS like really personifies this by bringing the best of web technology to mobile and touch platforms. But what's going on here with the merging of these two worlds?
Yeah, it's really sort of interesting when you think about it, about modern computing experiences. I used to work for Acer America back in the mid-90s. If you recall in the industry, this was when computing really transitioned from sort of a hobbyist and geeks to mainstream. And PCs were marketed really aggressively for the first time across all manufacturers to mainstream consumers. But when you start to think about it, the mobile operating system experience is so much more tailored for the consumer. It's a really consumer-grade experience versus the workstation-y experiences that we have in these sort of desktop-class operating systems. And we think this key difference is what causes statements like this to be made. You know, back when HP first announced the acquisition of Palm, Mark Hurd made this statement: we didn't buy Palm just to be in the smartphone business. And some people, to be fair, the quote was actually didn't have the word just, and so a lot of people sort of read into that something that wasn't intended. The quote was intended to say that we see potential for a consumer-grade operating system across a whole variety of products in their portfolio. And then you look at what some other people in the industry are doing as far as convergence with mobile and desktop, and you realize these ecosystems are going to come together. At some point, the desktop will be as friendly as mobile's experiences for consumers. And when that happens, the world that we live in is going to change. And the fragmentation that we see in mobile sort of reminds us of the fragmentation that we used to have in desktop PCs. And there used to be a really big variety of players in that ecosystem with different operating system and hardware types. And eventually, all of that consolidated into one big winner. And a lot of other people tried to go into that space, but really weren't able to succeed. And when you have one player that dominates the industry so extensively, you get things like this, right?
Exactly. So what happened last time around? You know, Windows, Microsoft was really dominant. They now see that the future can be these consumer-grade operating systems that they don't have an investment into the level of
competitors. Say something so I can get this off the slide, you know what
okay,
I mean?
Okay, but it's just so beautiful. But the web came around, right? And the web actually really kind of saved the day here, because it was kind of a virtual machine into the experiences that our users actually wanted. The cool things of the time were all on the web. Before that, people wanted Office and those kind of applications, and so Windows had that locked down. But now things moved, and they wanted Facebook and Google and eBay and Amazon and all of these experiences that were utterly cross-platform. So the web was this fantastic cross-platform solution that kind of hit us on the desktop. And we think without the web and things like Microsoft going to Apple and giving them some money and getting Office on there and things like that actually saved companies like Apple on the desktop world.
And so Mozilla was really instrumental in making this happen. And this is something that we feel a lot of gratitude, because at the time Mozilla focused on making sure that the web stayed this independent resource. They didn't really have a business model. They're just a bunch of volunteers that were really sort of devoted to this cause. And it really has opened up a lot of opportunity in the industry. But there is a problem with web applications, and that's monetization. Because the standard for monetization of web applications... it could use some improvement. I mean, some of the ads that you put on websites are downright shady, like the ad at the bottom, like tiny wireless camera with an attractive... What are they implying with that ad? You know, it's just...
And so, yeah, this is what Google wants you to do to monetize, just slap some ads. And you're building this great experience, and then you've got things that are just going to pop in that you have utterly no control over, and CPMs are going down over time. And so surely the web needs more, and we can deliver more. Now, there's obviously great examples of people doing services and freemium and all of this different stuff to deliver great experiences, and actually by giving you that value, charging for it accordingly. But we think that there's even better ways and opportunities for developers to kind of monetize the value that they have, and that's in the app stores.
Yeah, mobile does this really, really well. Mobile app stores, they don't require you to set up any infrastructure. They don't require you to even think that much about advertising your product. That can happen just within the storefront. Discovery is all self-contained. It's a sort of brainless experience in order to distribute and monetize applications. And so we think it's actually really sort of exciting to have the web world sort of mix with the mobile distribution world for applications. You sort of get the best of both worlds in a sense.
Yeah, and all of the modern frameworks that were kind of developed for the web on the desktop, they've all been revved, right? With jQuery, we've got jQuery Mobile, Sprout Core, it's got Sprout Core Touch, Censure Touch. So we've got all of these kind of first-class citizens coming up to the table from the desktop web to the mobile web. Through Palm, web's native, so you don't have to do anything special, but for other platforms, you've still got a path going through PhoneGap that we're going to be talking about today, too.
But sometimes people think that native sort of proprietary applications are the only way to achieve really first-class experiences in mobile. And this is an interesting case study that we stumbled across. So if you look at the Delta application that's available on another platform, I'm not sure which one this is, when you go to the mobile website, the first thing the mobile website does is steer you towards the native application. And if you stay on the website, the first screen, this is the second screen on the bottom column there, on the bottom row is my pointer there, no, it's not there. You look at it and you think, well, that looks sort of decent, and then you click through on the third on the bottom here, and it's just kind of a simple text website, whereas the one on the top is dynamic with rich graphics and all kinds of effects, and you might think, well, geez, you know, maybe the web platform can't deliver the sorts of experiences that people want.
But it can. We actually went through and kind of played around with this example to kind of show how you can make this native, and it's actually just where you put in your time and your effort. It's very easy to kind of go off to a new platform and have another team kind of work on this stuff. But using the web, you can just kind of go to this new kind of client-oriented technology. But all of the technology that we're going to talk about today, with being able to do the rich effects and graphics are used to in native, you can do through CSS. All of these new APIs that give you access to native capabilities, you can do that stuff too. Through PhoneGap, you can access device capabilities. Through the mobile web itself, you can do a lot of rich things. Here's just kind of a simple example. It's
for some reason, the Alpha Blend didn't work on the demo, but trust me, it works. It works.
Yes,
it works.
Yes. But this is all just a few lines of code. You can just go through and just add some CSS, and Dave Balmer is going to be talking about building these rockstar applications using web technology. We feel like you can use technology to deliver these native-like experiences.
So another company that we have here at the show today put this to the test, a company called Strobe. They have this framework called Sprout Core. And what happened is NPR released a native iPad application. And they looked at it and they said, you know, we could do this with web technologies. And they did it. They created a HTML5 version of NPR's app. And it looks and feels better than the native equivalent. And so Charles is going to be here at the cross-platform panel too. But this stuff is actually real. You can actually do amazing UI with the web platform. But if for whatever reason you do actually need to do a native UI, one of the things that we're excited about is technologies like Accelerator Titanium that are actually JavaScript technologies but wrap the native experience. So you can actually architect a solution that for most platforms targets the web, and where you need a particular native component on an operating system like Android or iPhone or some other one, you can actually incorporate that too and have a dramatic amount of code reuse across your code base. And so as we look at the landscape, we feel really excited about the fact that web technologies can power amazing user interfaces, but there actually are options out there if you actually need to take that existing code base and just sprinkle a little bit of the native stuff here and there to provide for you an opportunity to leverage your code across all these different environments.
Yeah, and so that's why we kind of went out there to start this this new company, Set Direction, to kind of take the religion that everyone in the WebOS community has about building these mobile web applications and kind of taking it to other communities too, to kind of really show people how you can make these amazing experiences, make them cross-platform, get into all of the different ecosystems that are out there, and just kind of use the web as this just amazing platform for developers by developers.
Yeah, that was one of the things that, so a lot of people have asked us, so how come you're not at HP anymore? We felt a little bit like we were preaching to the converted, and at the same time, it was increasingly awkward for us to spend time in other communities trying to get them to use the web too, and so we're really excited that we have the opportunity to spend time with you in the community and also reach out to these other communities. So that's what we wanted to share with you this morning. We're sort of the outside industry perspective keynote. Right after us, Phil McKinney, CTO of PSG at HP, is going to come up and talk to you about HP's perspectives on WebOS. And then after Phil, Joe Hayashi, who's the VP of Product Management for WebOS, is here to talk more about sort of what's happening with WebOS and what you can expect moving forward. Before we shift over to Phil, though, we wanted to talk to you about the agenda of sessions that that we have planned for today. Specifically, we wanted to try something a little different. We wanted to argue about which session you should attend to give you a better perspective on what you can expect. So to start out with the first hour, who do you want to take?
So I'll take PhoneGap on the left there. So we talked about how we believe that you can build these web applications cross-platform and use solutions like PhoneGap to get you across all of these different platforms using just kind of raw web technology. If you want to learn how to get into all these different ecosystems and how it works on WebOS, go listen to Brian LaRue from Natobi, one of the founders of PhoneGap, share how you actually go about doing that.
So I don't think you should go to Brian's talk at all. I think you should go to Ben's talk, because Ben, so he used to work at Mozilla. He is super talented on low-level programming in C and C++, but he's also really knowledgeable about web development because he used to build browsers over at Mozilla, and he's going to talk to you about how you can combine web code and native code to create really amazing applications and how you can run those on other platforms also. And in the next hour, I think you should stay right in the same track and hit Greg Simon's talk. So Greg is one of the core engineers that was responsible for WebOS in the first place. He's a freaking super genius. And he's going to talk to you about how to optimize your applications to run as fast and as best as they can on our WebKit. I don't see how you could conceivably go to another session, frankly, at that hour.
If you care about making money, for example, you may want to go to the marketing your app session. Joe, you know, like really has studied all of the different app ecosystems, knows WebOS inside and out. And if you really want to understand the business side of WebOS and making money on the platform, go hear Joe Sherry's wisdom there.
So we didn't want you to have to compete for our session at 1:40, so you really have no choice there. But during the lunch, we have a bunch of lightning talks, too, that are going to be great, these sort of fast-moving, bite-sized talks. And then at the 2:50 hour, I really want you to go to David Ballmer's talk, because David Ballmer, so this cat presented at a developer day before as an outside member of the community, and we were so impressed with his experience and his perspectives that we had him sort of cross the line and join us at Palm. And he's going to talk to you about all the different web frameworks that are out there, and he's even got a framework that he's created called Joe that is really impressive, but it gives him the perspective to be able to sort of evaluate the other frameworks too. So it's a fantastic talk. I don't know how you're going to top that one.
Does anyone use the Facebook app? Over there? Okay, a few hands. Thank you. Kevin Decker is the core engineer on that application, and WebOS 2.0 has a lot of new features. Gray Norton is in charge of the SDK from a PM perspective. They're going to tag team, show you how to make these amazing experiences on WebOS 2.0, giving you it through a case study of Facebook itself. So you'll really understand all of the new features that are available to you.
So in the next hour, I'm going to make it easy. I'm going to say stick with David. He's going to switch rooms. And he's going to do an updated version of the talk that we thought was so impressive at the original Dev Day to show you how you can get rich effects and graphics out of WebOS. Great talk.
So until WebOS 2.0, you haven't been able to create services on the other side of the service bus until WebOS 2.0. Now you can do that using JavaScript. And even better than that, it uses Node.js, a fantastic community, a fantastic open source framework. And so Kevin Haig, who's a great engineer on our team when we're running things in DevRel, he's going to go through what it's like to build these services soup to nuts, so you'll be able to kind of build these fantastic new services for 2.0.
And finally, you got no choice at 5:10. We're going to give you a peek at what's happening in the next generation framework for WebOS development. So listen, we're going to hand the time over to Phil McKinney now. Thank you so much for coming. Really delighted to have you here. We hope you have a fantastic time. Thanks.
Thanks, guys. Wow. I'll tell you one thing. I'm not, for those of you who follow me on Twitter, you probably got to see the my travel excitements over the last 36 hours trying to get here to this event. So I started yesterday in New Delhi, HP. I was in New Delhi. We had just announced a new web services product aimed specifically at the emerging markets called DreamScreen. So I was there for that launch and was really committed to getting here. And then everything that could go wrong on a travel day went wrong, except for the fact that there was actually a mechanical problem on a plane that caused my connecting flight to be delayed by 7 hours. Now, most people don't like 7-hour delays, but that 7-hour delay is what allowed me to get here at like 1:30 this morning, which I actually ran into some of the guys in the lobby this morning when I got into the hotel. So I'm really glad to be here. I've been doing PowerPoint slides. I've been on the road for the last 12 or 13 days doing series of speeches, so I'm PowerPointed out. So there'll be no PowerPoint slides. So I'm just going to share with you for about 20 minutes or so, but then I want to leave some time for Q&A. So questions you might have that you want to direct to me, you know, start thinking about those, and we'll leave time to do that. And then I'll be here till about 1 o'clock, so I'll be here through lunch. But then I've got to go get on another airplane and head off to the next destination. But I did want to spend some time here giving you a little bit of the HP perspective. So as many of you know, I'm the Chief Technology Officer for HP's Personal Systems Group. So that means I have responsibility for all the PCs, laptops, mobile devices, displays, workstations, home storage devices, calculators. We still make calculators. It's not bad when you can build a product that you launch in 1972 and you're still shipping it. Great margin. And so that's about 40 billion of HP's 120 billion in revenue. But give you a little bit about my background. I joined HP about 8 years ago. I came in on a 1-year deal. I was retired. I'd cashed out as a founder at a company called Telligent, grew that to $3 billion, cashed out. I get the Silver Star for timing. Cashing out, you know, I take timing over brains any day of the week, right? So I get out before the dot-com bust. But I'd spent 20 years of my life in the mobile space. So I did the original 1984 trial in Chicago, so market number one in the world. I did all the original analog networks in the US. I launched Nextel. I did the original GSMs, Europolitan.com, Mannesmann in Germany. I built MTN in South Africa. I did Sterling, the first GSM operator in India. Sapura, the first in Southeast Asia. And then came back and I did OmniPoint, the first GSM operator. So I'd spent my entire life traveling around the world building wireless building the wireless networks, the infrastructure that we all enjoy today. And so I came out of retirement, agreed to come to HP on a 1-year deal. Now the joke is I've now renewed 7 times. Or the flip side, the way I tell the story is my prison sentence has been extended for bad behavior, and I'm still here. But HP has had a long history in the mobile space, and obviously being very committed to the mobile space. A lot of you may not realize about HP's role in the mobile networking space today. You think about, okay, we acquired Palm, but you may not realize, for instance, the basic core software that enables text messaging, the SMSCs, that actually sit inside the core network, HP has 71% market share of the SMSC software. Actually, HP created that software in the original launch of the GSM operators in the early 90s. So actually, HP's technology currently enables about, you know, 8 or 9 trillion SMS messages a year going through the SMSCs. That's the actual core software. SS7, the voice protocol that operates both on the wireline and on the wireless side of the network. HP is actually the inventor of the SS7 protocol stack, and HP has about 75%. So if you pick up a phone and you hear a dial tone, that's HP. Now you don't realize it because it's all embedded in the core network. You don't realize it. HP, 320,000 employees. We operate in 171 countries. We have 47,000 engineers. That's not managers, that's not supervisors, that's 47,000 engineers whose job is to sit at desks and design and build products each and every day. 450 PhD researchers in HP labs inventing technologies that are going to be 5 to 20 years out. Now, why Palm? Why did HP, why did we take such a keen focus in Palm? Beyond the fact that there's a number of people at HP who all worked at Palm in different stages throughout its existence. It started off About 18 months ago, when we started this, we started down the path of looking at the fundamental transition. You know, Ben and Dion talked about this, you know, convergence between mobile devices and desktop devices. And we clearly saw this shift coming. And for us, it was recognizing the fact that it wasn't an either-or situation, that the industry was really screaming for an and. How do you bring those two platforms together? And when we also committed to the fact, or got convinced ourselves to the fact, that in order to really deliver what we needed in the marketplace, it wasn't the model of HP simply building hardware and using third-party software on a device wasn't the model that was going to work. We needed to have a much tighter relationship to an operating system. At the same time, we're not into proprietary operating systems. That's not the mode of operation for HP. In one of my sideline jobs, I'm responsible for industry standards for all of HP. So just to kind of give you the context, today we sit on about 175 standards bodies, about 800 working committees across all of the industry standards. So for instance, Steve Mills, who's the president of IEEE, he is on my staff. Jim Bell, who sits on the board at W3C and who's been on the board of W3C since the beginning, Jim is on my staff. JTC1 is the International Technology Standards Bodies. All the standards bodies underneath report to JTC1. The chairwoman for JTC1, Karen Higginbottom, is on my staff. So we are, HP's philosophy is all about open standards. We think it's good for the industry, and we think it's good for the customer. So when we started looking at approaches that said we needed to figure out a different way to deliver an experience, for us it was about identifying an operating system that embraced embraced standards that the industry was moving towards, the direction. And so our focus quickly shifted to the work that Palm had already done on WebOS. And so for HP, on the acquisition of Palm was one, obviously, to accelerate HP's position in the mobile phone space, but one of the key assets that we focused in on was WebOS. And as you've heard, for us, WebOS is not just about WebOS on phones. It's about WebOS on a variety of different form factors. And I'm just going to take 2 minutes here and give you a little bit of insight about how we think about form factors. One of the common questions I get is, you know, what are the new form factors that are coming out, right? So everybody, you know, I get the tweets on a regular basis, everybody wanting me to either drop a hint or tell you what bar I go to so you could check out the bar stool, right, to see if I leave anything on a bar stool that could give you a hint on the form factors. But let me give you a little bit of insight on a generic perspective about how we think about form factors. And the way we think about form factors is across two dimensions. Think of it as a two-dimensional chart. Horizontal dimension is what I would call reach or mobility. How mobile is the experience? The other dimension, vertical dimension, is richness. How rich of an experience can you get? So think about it. In the upper left-hand corner, I'll put my 60-inch TV, right? Beautiful, 7.1 surround sound in my living room. I'm not going to take it off the wall. Not a very mobile experience. Bottom right-hand corner, put your basic flip mobile phone. Right? Fits in your pocket, nice and mobile, not a very rich experience. Now you can draw a diagonal line and you can pretty much lay out every product in the industry. So from the TVs, you come down on the diagonal, desktops. Right? Come down a little bit further, notebooks. So coming from a PC perspective. Right? Notebooks, more mobile, but I give up a little bit on the richness. From a basic mobile phone, I come up the diagonal, next step up is a smartphone, right? Keyboard, screen, may not be able to fit in my pocket, I gotta wear a jacket, put it in a holster, stick it in my purse. What's really emerged over the last 24 months is this gap between what is a phone and what is a PC. And this gap is narrowing, and you're starting to see this overlap occurring. Now, everybody always asks, why can't we build the one perfect product? I just want to carry one device. I don't want to carry five devices. I just want to carry one device. Now, I know I'm a little bit of a freak. I've got five phones that I carry. But the reality is each one of us is carrying 2 to 3 devices. And my perspective is that we're actually going to see an explosion of form factors. Not fewer, but an absolute explosion in form factors. Why? Because of this trend we refer to as consumer-driven innovation. Consumers, not what enterprise customers buy, not what businesses buy. Consumers are driving the innovation cycle. It's this insatiable desire for new things, the new gadgets, the new devices, the new applications. And the reality is though, we all have different needs and wants. The 2 or 3 devices that I want are probably different than the 2 or 3 devices that Ben or Dion want, or any of you in this room want, because each of us have different jobs, different tasks, right? So in addition to my job at HP, I also write a regular column at Forbes, and me typing out my 1,100 words that I have to do for my editor, you know, thumb typing, not going to do my 1,100 word article thumb typing. But for others, using a Slate device or a tablet device or a pad device, whatever term you want to use for that form factor may be the optimal device for people. So this gap between what is a PC and what is a phone is going to collapse, and it's going to collapse in unique and startling ways this year. For instance, a year ago, if someone had come to me and said, "Hey, Phil, I need a device. I need a little bit bigger screen. I want a keyboard on it. But I need the battery life to go more than 24 hours, and I need it to be always on and have 0 boot time when I hit the on button." Well, the only option a year ago would have been smartphone. Buy yourself a smartphone, but that means you're thumb typing. 9 months ago, HP, we released a little test product called the AirLife 100, and it's always on. 0 boot time. My Air Life I can go about 3 days between charges. It has a 93% keyboard. So take a normal traditional keyboard, it's 93% the size of a normal keyboard, and a 10-inch touchscreen. Now you have an option. Do you want a thumb type, or do you want a full keyboard to do the functions? That's what you're going to see. We're going to see an explosion of devices. They're going to give the consumers the ability to pick the best 2 or 3 devices. And for HP, those device form factors are going to be devices that we will be focusing WebOS to be made available on. It's not WebOS just on phones. It was quite interesting when we announced the acquisition and we got to the first earnings release. And there's a few of us who get involved in kind of proofreading what the executives are supposed to say during the earnings release. And this was a little bit of my introduction to Ben and Dion, because it was like right after this earnings release, is if you saw the video interview that Ben and Dion did with me, we spent a little bit of time in that interview clarifying what some of the other HP executives had said, particularly about mobile phones. Ben and Dion, you guys were very kind at editing Mark's quote there on the screen. But another quote that gets a lot of attention is Mark and Todd were making comments during the earnings release call, and they mentioned, or Mark got overly excited and mentioned about WebOS printers. So we get a lot of questions about, why would we WebOS on printers? What is the thinking on that one, right? Well, you have to understand a little bit about what happens inside of HP. With regards to the WebOS printers, HP just released a series of printers called TouchSmart printers. So TouchSmart PCs are all-in-one touch product that we're shipping in consumer retail around the world. There's a TouchSmart printer that allows you to run local apps on a printer that have some form of print component. So some of these apps consist of Fandango, for instance, is a partner in this product. So now you can go to your printer, you can hit the button for Fandango, and you can do the entire buying of your ticket. You don't have to go to a PC and hook it up or boot your PC. You literally can do it completely from a printer. You can do Google driving directions. You can use Google Maps and do your driving directions right from the printer. So the theory is that there's going to and we're seeing a lot of interest in putting apps on this printer. One that actually it generates a lot of pages printed is the Disney app. Now, I'm a little bit different in my stage of life. All my kids are grown and gone. My daughters are both married, but they have not yet blessed me with my first grandchild yet. But when they do, this will probably be the app that I'll use. The Disney app allows you to go in and pick a Disney character, like one of the princesses, and then you can actually print out coloring pages to give to your kids to then color, right? So you have an instant coloring book available with the latest and greatest of the Disney characters. It generates a lot of pages print, which means it uses up a lot of ink. That's good. You know? We like ink. We like printing. Print in color. Actually, here's one little deep, dark secret about HP. People always ask, whenever an HP person does a presentation, you'll always notice that the background on the slides are blue. Why? It uses the most ink when a customer prints your slides. So, little subtlety there. So if you get slides from me and they got a blue background, just read them online, you know? So for us, WebOS, as I said before, we're gonna see the explosion of these devices. And for us, the excitement about WebOS within HP is unbelievable. Now, for those of you, again, who follow me on Twitter or who've read the stories about, for instance, the app challenge that I gave inside of HP, I probably will rethink that challenge this year. I didn't quite well think it out when I launched it inside of HP because I thought I'd get a couple hundred apps. We ended up at about 780 apps. I had one person on my team who has done nothing full-time for almost 7 months just managing that app contest inside of HP. We ended up with some phenomenal apps. Some of those apps we cannot release into the catalog because they contain research that's occurring in HP Labs. It's not ready to be revealed as of yet. But a number of those apps will start to get released into the catalog, so you'll start seeing. And a lot of those apps are, one app is an example, which I thought was really great. An HP engineer who actually is a sales support engineer, which means they go out with the sales teams to sell servers. Him and his 14-year-old son sat down on a weekend and wrote a WebOS app. His son is really a big basketball player in school. The father coaches the team. And so they wrote an app for WebOS that allows the parents and the scorekeepers at like a youth game to be able to keep track of the players, where they took the shot from on the floor, whether it was a miss or a hit, where the fouls occurred, and they do it all simply by just tapping the screen. And then they can come back and play back the entire game, post the whole game experience. So him, this HP engineer and his son wrote this app. They wrote it in a weekend. Then the engineer then sat down and they actually recorded a video, which I sent then back into Palm, giving feedback on the experience, given that they had no experience with WebOS, the experience about writing this app. And I know this video's kind of made its rounds inside of Palm as part of the feedback. So the excitement inside of HP for WebOS is never ending. In fact, we're getting to the point where my team, we're doing a little bit of trying to corral it because otherwise we would, 320,000 employees, 47,000 engineers, all wanting to come over here and help WebOS, So it's like the elephant. We have to be careful where the elephant steps because we can, we know we can cause damage. So we've been doing a little bit of trying to bring this and manage this appropriately. But we have taken a significant size of engineering teams and actually moved them to Palm. So it isn't a situation where, Palm comes up, HP, we're investing a significant amount of capital. There's my phone reminding me that it's quarter till, right? You always tell when your Palm phone goes off. We're investing a significant amount of capital into accelerating and expanding. There's lots of jobs at Palm, so if you know people who you think would be a good fit, we're hiring at a pretty substantial rate, but we took a significant core of HP engineers and actually moved them to Palm. Didn't take the Palm team and chop them up. You know, we actually just picked them up, and they now report into Rubenstein's organization within Palm, under the Palm leadership, underneath the Palm management structure, as a way to, again, accelerate this whole process. So for HP, we are extremely excited about WebOS. I'm glad I was able to make it here today to spend some time with you. But before I open it up for Q&A, I did want to talk a little bit about just 2 minutes on HP Labs. So HP Labs, like I said, 450 PhD researchers. Now, I typically think of myself as having an above average IQ. Till you go hang out at Labs. And then it's a very humbling experience. We have some of the top researchers in the world, Dr. Stan Williams, UCLA. He is one of the top nanotechnology researchers in the world. In fact, MIT Tech Review, Stan and his team developed an entirely new kind of memory called Memristor. And MIT Tech Review magazine named it as one of the most important patents for the computer industry for the next 50 years. This is going to fundamentally change how computers are designed and how computers are developed. Dr. Susie Wee. Susie actually reports to me. She used to be one of the lab directors. If you're familiar, for instance, with NTT Docomo being the very first mobile phone operator to do streaming video and streaming TVs, that's all Susie's work. We did that actually as a co-innovation project with Docomo 7 years ago. Susie's also the author of the JPEG 2000 standard. She just got inducted into the Women's in Technology Hall of Fame. And is quite well known, particularly in video compression and video technologies. Carl Tausig is one of the leading experts in alternative future display technologies. And I'm always known to bring show and tell, so I did bring a sample. For those of you probably seen some of the videos in the past, but this is an actual sample of HP's work in flexible displays. So this is a concept of what we call continuous roll manufacturing. So rather than normal display technologies being going through the normal process of creating LCDs, these display technologies are literally printed. It's a Mylar film, the same Mylar film we use for a flexible solar array. So if you see the military where they unroll these large solar panels out on the ground to power up tents or remote locations. This is the exact same Mylar film. It's a modified Mylar film with a special coating, and we can literally print the display. We believe that we're going to be able to get this down to a price point where you're going to see what we call ubiquitous displays, every surface. The tabletops in front of you, the walls around the room, all will have this display technology built on it. This is full color, full touch. It's bistable. So kind of like an e-ink. The difference is, though, is I can drive this to a refresh rate to show full video. So in a bistable state, very power efficient, or you can drive it to a full video rate. Our view is that when you think about, make sure I pull out the right device. And now everyone's going to be pickpocketing me to see what else is in my pocket. So Palm Pre 2, right? When you think about the compute power that's in one of these devices, we can do probably 70% of our day-to-day tasks, 85% of our day-to-day tasks, about what's in our pocket. The limiting factor is screen and keyboard. If I have this in my pocket, and I have this as a ubiquitous surface mounted on walls and on tabletops all over, that I can just simply walk up to and take over control of that display and use it as my display and then walk away and find a display someplace else. It changes the whole concept of what form factors in the future are going to look like. Today, we buy laptops and desktops because I need the keyboard and I need the screen to be able to carry the screen and the keyboard with me. But if I can detach the keyboard and screen requirement and detach it from the device, we can eventually potentially get down to a single kind of form factor device that we carry in our pocket that ultimately allows us to reduce the number of devices that we're carrying. So this is just one sample. I'll have this at lunch, so you can feel free to come up, touch it. It's not going to bite you. It's a non-functioning version, obviously. because it needs to be something that I can easily carry with me as I go around the world. But I think this is just one example of the commitment that HP has to long-range R&D that we believe is going to be a great source of innovations for Palm and drive what we see as the future for this convergence of mobiles and desktops. So at this point, I'm going to shut up because I can sit here and ramble, plus my jet lag, is I can feel the jet lag starting to fade in on me here. So I'm going to shut up, and we're going to take Q&A. So if you have questions, we have microphones, so feel free. Thank you. So if you have a question, raise your hand, and they'll get a microphone to you. Otherwise, I'm not going to be able to hear you. So we got one here.
Hi, thanks for the chat. Yep. You mentioned that consumers are driving innovation. And so I'm just wondering, over the next 6 months, what are you guys going to do to make sure that consumers actually have an awareness of WebOS? Because in the consumer market, perception tends to be reality. And unfortunately, it seems like WebOS isn't as much in the conversation for the average consumer as it ought to be.
Yeah, I mean, there's work that's underway inside of HP about raising the visibility on WebOS, et cetera. But it's easier to do that when you've got new devices that you can show rather than the same, you know, what we have today. Other than we're working pretty hard on the WebOS 2.0, making WebOS 2.0 available. So I think, you know, what you'll see is start accelerating and raising the visibility on WebOS timed with some of the new devices that are coming out that we're really excited about. Some of those we've talked about, so you've heard both John and Todd be quoted a couple of different places. John most recently at the Web 2.0 conference this last week about the tablet, slate, pad, whatever term you want to use for a larger screen device that'll come out in 2011. There's a whole series, obviously, we're working on new phones, and we're also working on some really interesting new form factors. So for you as a development community, the way to think about this is HP's investment into Palm, the money that we're putting into Palm is not just only, we are expanding the phone devices that are in development, you'll see an expansion on that, but you're also going to see a whole wide range of additional form factors of devices that HP can take advantage, given our footprint in 170 countries and 98,000 retail outlets. If you don't realize, HP, we're the largest consumer electronics company in the world based on shelf space that we control. We control about 10% of the consumer electronics retail shelf space worldwide, largest of anybody in the world. And we need devices to go onto those shelf space. And Palm is going to play an important part of those devices that are going to go onto those shelves on a global basis. But the timing for what you're going to see as part of the acceleration of the message is going to be tied to as we roll out and bring to market some of these new devices. Oh, one right here.
So for those of us that are independent developers looking at apps that we can place, we're interested in two parts of that. One, I'm encouraged by when I hear that there's going to be an ecology of devices running in WebOS.
And right.
That's very important to us. The other part that we're starting to look at is the necessity that we have to get our apps into enterprise situations without putting them on the public app store.
Okay.
And so I'm going to ask.
Yeah, so particularly, obviously, HP, where you think about within just our PC business, which includes Palm, a little bit more than half our revenue of the $40 billion comes from consumer. So it's about, you know, 55-45, you can think about it that way. The larger portion is consumer, the smaller portion is business enterprise customers. So we call them the global 1,000, which is the dominant position of that, and then small and medium-sized businesses. There's a lot of discussions because the enterprise customers are keenly interested in being able to, quote, host their own app store. They don't want it in the public catalog. They want to be able to host it, you know, in their own private catalog. Some enterprises have already done this. They create the applications. They flag it as a private beta, and then they distribute it themselves through the WebOS methods already. So a number of large enterprise customers are already using WebOS but they're using the private beta option as a way to distribute those apps, but it doesn't quite give them the control that they want. Yeah, exactly. So one of the things that we are looking at, I'm not announcing anything, but it is an area that we're keenly interested in just because of HP's sheer footprint in the enterprise customers. And I can tell you, Procter & Gamble, Kraft, Mayo Clinic, British Telecom, even for their internal use, Unilever, Philips Healthcare, who I met with in Tel Aviv on Monday and Tuesday, all have asked the exact same question. So I can tell you without, I'm not announcing anything, but I can tell you that it's an area of keen interest for us is to allow for enterprises to establish a catalog of approved applications that they can make available, that you as the app developers looking at how to help you on the monetization of that, but give the enterprises the control of being able to manage what apps they make available to their employees. So it's on the list. Next question. Someone's got to point them out. Who's got the next microphone? Which one? Yep. Oh, back here, way in the back.
With the scope that HP gets revenue from corporations, like everything from consumers to corporation, enterprise, everything else like that, 10 to 15 years from now, where do you see WebOS fitting in as a percent?
Well, that I can't do. We're actually in what's called quiet period. So actually, HP's earning release is Monday afternoon after the stock market closes. So leading the 3 weeks leading up to earnings release, we go into what's called quiet period. So unless you want to see me in handcuffs and going to a federal jail this afternoon, I can't give you that kind of a projection. What I can tell you is that WebOS has gotten the attention of everybody in the entire organization. So in fact, we have a new CEO, Leo. I've already had to give Leo the briefing. John has already been in with Leo. Leo is keenly interested in WebOS and how do we take WebOS and how do we accelerate it. Another one of my jobs, I also run inside of HP what's called the open source group. So today, HP, we ship about 8,000 products around the world that have some component of open source. So I have a dedicated team that focused, headed up by Phil Robb, who focuses on supporting not only our internal open source efforts, but also in our contributions that we make back into the open source community. So for instance, a lot of you may not realize, but the high availability code that's embedded as part of Linux for allowing you to do cluster high availability, that all came out of HP's HA product that was actually part of HP UX, our version of Unix. We actually released that back into the open source community and worked on delivering cluster high availability into the base Linux distributions. So we have a pretty committed space. So from us, it's everything from our open source, our internal open source community, but all the way through to the executives are keenly interested and are committed that WebOS will be a significant level of importance from the standpoint of an operating system that you will see across device platforms. So I'll leave it at that, otherwise slap the handcuffs on me. Okay, next question, right here.
Hi, Phil. I know that you're a big advocate on education, and I was wondering, do you have any plans to sort of push out WebOS type devices to educational schools or universities, as well as making deals with book publishers that focus on education. Because you talk a lot about like companies and enterprise, but what about on the education side? Because that's obviously a growing driving force with like ebooks now, and especially like textbooks going into the e-book market.
So maybe I'll give you 30 seconds on why I get this question from the standpoint that I'm on the record both with Jim Sheldon, who's the Deputy Secretary of Education here in the U.S., and I had a meeting 3 or 4 weeks ago with Secretary of State Hillary Clinton, where my position is that in the U.S., our educational systems are falling behind because we're producing kids that are the world's greatest test takers versus kids who really have critical and creative thinking skills, which are going to be needed to be competitive. Education is actually one of the 5 industry verticals that we focus on, so financial services, manufacturing, telecommunications, healthcare, and education. So education is one of the five key industry verticals, pan-HP across the entire business that we're focused on. With regards to the WebOS play, there's a couple different things. One is how do we use WebOS with app developers and content providers to make it, to give environments and platforms that allow it to be used as a supporting infrastructure. Secondarily is how do we support WebOS as a platform to teach creativity. Having kids, for instance, in schools create WebOS apps as part of projects and those types of things. There's a couple of test initiatives that we have underway. Jim Verdes, who runs what we call the education philanthropic side of HP, where we make donations. So we have a project every year where about 180 schools around the world can submit a proposal. We select the best proposals, and then we actually outfit their project. We give them devices and technologies and engineers to volunteer their time. Jim and I have already had that conversation, because traditionally it's been around tablet PCs has been the real interest in education, but mobile is clearly becoming the focus. And so you'll see us over the next couple of years kind of start to shift that to being much more of a mobile focus, where we actually encourage the use of how to use mobile in the educational process, in supporting the educational process. With regards to the book publishers, I just did a meeting, four or five weeks ago, where I met with, probably 11 or 12 publishers, one-on-one. And the number one question I got at the beginning of every one of those meetings was, oh my God, my business is failing. How do you help us save my publishing business? The problem is that industry moves extremely slow. So we're working with them, but it's a very, very slow process. But education, as you pointed out, is one of the key areas. It's a personal passion for me, because otherwise we're not going to have a workforce that's going to be competitive on a global scale if we don't start thinking about particularly the K-12 segment today. Because by the time they get into college, they're the ones that are going to be supporting all of our retirements. And we want to make sure we got the most competitive workforce. And it's not just me. I'm also working with the head of education in Singapore. I had a meeting when I was in Delhi with the educational department in India, same thing in Israel. So my belief is that on a global scale, for us to be competitive, no matter where your home nation is, education has got to become a priority, and we need to think of unique and different ways. And for me, obviously, if I can figure out ways to use WebOS as a leverage point for that, either teaching kids to write, use things like Aries to write applications as part of a project that gets them interested and exciting about web standards and web technologies, that's a win-win for everybody. Okay, next question. Okay, one more, I'll do one more. One more. We'll do it right here.
We hear a lot about HP's global reach, but right now users can only buy applications if there's a cell phone carrier in their country selling a WebOS phone.
Right.
Are we going to see that opening up in the next 6 months?
Well, I don't know about the next 6 months, because again, that would be a projection and I'd find myself in federal handcuffs. Obviously the interest is how do we get the app footprint to be as broad as possible to allow you as the app developers to be able to monetize that everywhere in the world, whether or not there's a carrier in that country. Because in some, for instance, the US is a little bit different because there's a phone subsidization model. Other parts of the world, there is no phone subsidization model. In fact, the number one question I got when I was in Tel Aviv on Monday and Tuesday, because there is really no carrier in Israel that's carrying the Palm Pre or Pixies today, and it was the number one question I got was when are we going to bring the phones to the rest of the countries and the rest of the world? Or people are buying, obviously, unlocked phones, and how do they get the advantages of ease of the WebOS updates, and how do they get the app catalog piece? So I can tell you it's something that we're constantly working on. Making the app stores available on a global basis is obviously a priority for us. From the standpoint, because the apps drive excitement around the device, and we recognize that that's important for you as developers to be able to get the broadest monetization base as possible. So I can tell you that it is a priority for us. Okay? With that, like I said, I'll be here till 1 o'clock, so if you want to catch me, chat, you've got ideas or you've got an interesting app you think I should take a look at. I already had one app snuck onto my phone last night in the lobby of the hotel. for me to take a look at last night. Yes, I was playing with it last night. But feel free, like I said, I'll be here till 1 o'clock. And again, thank you for your support for Palm. I'm extremely excited, you know, about the acquisition. I spent a lot of time annoying all the engineers at Palm. They're barring the doors. They're going to take away my Palm ID soon because I'm too much of a harassment to them. But I can tell you that HP, we're extremely excited. And from HP, we thank you for your support in being here. And if you've got apps in the catalog, thank you. And we appreciate your support for the products. Thank you.
Hi there. I'm not sure which one of these computers I'm supposed to look at. Is there a way I can see this? We're here. Okay. So hi, my name is Joe Hayashi. I am responsible for the product management team around WebOS. We work with the engineers and the rest of the team to basically build WebOS, and we're excited to be here today. I need the clicker as well. Where's the clicker? There we go. All right. And we left ourselves a lot of time to basically finish this. So what I wanted to do was figure out how to use the clicker. Is this the right clicker?
No.
It's a test. They put multiple clickers up here. All right. So in the few minutes that we have left before the next session, I just wanted to kind of give you guys a quick update on sort of where we are with WebOS 2.0. There's some important details that we want to share with you in terms of how we're rolling that out and how it impacts what you're doing with your apps right now. And then if you look at the agenda from today, as you saw, there's a lot of topics, in particular a lot of cross-platform topics. And I wanted to kind of put those in context with, you know, Mojo and all these cross-platform frameworks and also this new framework that we're introducing today as well. So we have a lot of great details to share with you, and I just want to provide some context for that. Before I do that, I guess I'll start where Phil left off. I think one of the things that we're very aware of at HP Palm is how lucky we are. We think that we have the best customers, we think we have the best developers, and we think we have the best homebrew community of any platform out there. And it's a real privilege. It's a real privilege to be able to work with you guys and to have such great customers. We're lucky, we understand that, we know that, and we're very grateful for that, so thank you. And the reason that we know that we have the best homebrew community is because I looked at it on Google and it says that So the homebrew community has taken over this notion on the internet, and just to show that it's not just PageRank, I also looked at it on Bing. And so it must be true, right? So thank you. So a quick update on WebOS. So we just introduced WebOS recently in October, and we got some great reviews. And this is one of my favorite from Josh Sapolsky of Engadget. This is not just a good OS, it's a great OS. So we're really pleased with the reception that it's been getting. And it's here today. This is obviously a major release for us. There's really kind of two themes that we had when we were developing WebOS. One was to really kind of continue to drive the innovation that we basically introduced with WebOS to begin with. So things like using the web as a platform, Synergy, Touchstone, a lot of those things that we introduced first in the mobile marketplace, we kind of continued with WebOS 2.0. And the second thing that was really kind of drove the thinking behind WebOS is kind of opening up the platform. So it's definitely a request that we heard a lot is, hey, I want to be able to do these things that you guys are doing with Synergy. Now you can do those things. Now you can do stuff with Touchstone and Exhibition. So we've opened up a lot of stuff for you guys to play with. This is just a kind of a quick list. And you will hear more about some of this stuff later today. So there's a lot of great stuff in WebOS 2.0, and you should definitely take a look at it. If you're not, how many people are actually part of the early access program for WebOS 2.0. So great. So most people are already signed up for that. If you're not, it's very easy to get it. You go to our developer portal, developer.palm.com, sign up, and you can get in, and you can get the early 2.0 SDK. So we're rolling out WebOS 2.0 in a couple of phases. So if you have a new pre-2 basically, you have WebOS 2.0 on it today. And then we're rolling out a second phase of the software over the air. And as you know, we work with operators, and it takes a while sometimes to do those releases. So that's why we're doing this two-phase step. So first on the pre-2 on the new device, and then over the air. There are a couple of things, a couple of details that I just want to make you aware of. So if you're looking at 2.0 and you're saying, hey, you know, is everything in there in this first release? It's actually not, and I just wanted to call that to your attention. So there are three things in particular. One, exhibition isn't in the software that's on the pre-2. And then also full support for the JavaScript services and some of the Synergy APIs aren't there in that first phase. But that stuff is going to come in the SDK. So if you have the SDK, you'll be able to play with that the fastest way possible. And just want to give you that heads up that there's some pieces that are not yet in the consumer software. And then the other thing, and I just mentioned this, right? So the thing that you need to do if you don't have it, if you're looking at WebOS 2.0 today, is to go to the developer portal, sign up for the early access program, and you can get it. We have these forums that basically we communicate with you on various issues, and pay attention to those forums because we're going to share more information about the timing of when this stuff is going to be becoming available. So the forums are a great place of information about this stuff as we roll it out. So just some details around WebOS 2.0 coming in two phases between now and the next few weeks and months. Okay, so we get a lot of questions about the whole ecosystem. Phil talked about this a lot. But we have this great operating system, and then people say, well, show us new devices. And we did. We just showed you a brand new device, a pre-2. We think this is a great evolution of the original pre-product for us, which is obviously a hugely successful product for us. It's available right now. This week, we just introduced an unlocked version of that you can get. You all are going to get one anyway. But you can also go to our, you can get a discount as a developer to basically buy additional units. New devices, we've said over and over again, in a vague way, but I'm gonna repeat that new devices are coming in early 2011. So we've talked about Slate, we've also talked about phones. So stay tuned. And most importantly, I think what Phil really kind of emphasized is that, WebOS is really kind of the center of what HP is doing with mobility, and so we're really excited about that. Back at the ranch, and we really want you to be excited about that as well, because we think that's going to be great things for all of us. All right, so just trying to catch up a little bit on the agenda. So I wanted to just put in context for you some of the stuff that you're going to hear about later today and throughout the program. So choice is a great thing, and there's a lot of cross-platform topics on today's agenda, and there's lots of different frameworks out there that you can use as a developer. And these cross-platform frameworks solve a real developer problem today. We talked to a lot of you guys, and you say, hey, I love WebOS, want to develop for WebOS, but I also want to develop for other phones as well. And these frameworks are a great solution to that problem. And really, it's not a surprise that web technologies are a good solution, because the web itself has so many different choices from a development standpoint. And it's a real sort of fertile ground for solving problems. The web is is all about sort of universality and open standards. Tim Berners-Lee just has this new article in the Scientific American this month about the web, and he kind of reiterated what's so great about the web, and I pulled two things out of it last night. It's like universality and open standards, they basically lead to kind of this innovation, freedom, and choice, and that's a great thing for developers. So it makes it a little more complicated, but it's also, I think, at the end of the day, it's a real benefit for everyone. And you probably know the motto of Perl, there's more than one way to do it. That's kind of the way it is with web frameworks today. It's kind of always the way it's been on the web. That's what's coming to fruition on mobile as well. But it is a real benefit, because you have lots of choices and get lots of capability with that. So Enyo, we talked about, is also going to be on the agenda today. So Matt McNulty is going to be talking about that. That's our next generation framework for WebOS. And also, we're also talking about Mojo. So there's a lot of stuff that we're talking about in the agenda. And in terms of that, I just want to give you some timing and kind of advice about how to think about that. So the first thing is that I think it should be clear from what you're hearing today is that we're really committed to cross-platform development. So obviously, the web is a multi-platform environment. Well, we use the web technologies. We're really inspired by the web. And so we think that's a wonderful thing. And so you can use web technologies today to get cross-platform doing things like PhoneGap and these new frameworks. And going forward, you're going to continue to see a lot of great support from us in doing that. And so Greg is going to show you some stuff, and we think that's about providing a great runtime for web technologies on our devices. And also, we've been pretty successful with our PDK strategy. So if you use the plugin development kit, you probably know it's fairly easy to port applications to WebOS using the PDK, and that's also going to continue. So this has been a really successful thing for us, and we're investing a lot in it, and we think it's very important, and we think it solves a real problem for you guys. So that's good. In terms of Enyo, so we're going to give you a kind of a first look at that today at 5 p.m. that Matt's going to provide to you. Basically, it's our next generation framework. So the motivation, why are we doing this? Well, we've talked about in a vague way that there's more things that are coming. And as part of that, we have a lot of problems to solve for ourselves in terms of how do we bring applications to the platform. So we've basically selected Enyo and its technology to basically solve some of the problems that we face there in terms of multiple form factors, aspect ratios. And you can imagine the types of issues that you get when you start to introduce more devices. And so Enyo is definitely aimed at that problem. It's also aimed at performance. So we've learned a lot, I think, with Mojo over the last 18 months or so, and in terms of performance. And so Enyo takes a lot of that into consideration. It's modern, more modular. And it's also, I think, a lot of the learnings that we took from Aries have also made it their way into this framework. So come at 5 o'clock. You can hear about that. And basically, next year is going to be a transition year for us for our frameworks. And so we want to give you a heads up. This stuff is coming. We've always tried to be, I think, fairly transparent and upfront with you in terms of what we're doing, what we're thinking. And so there's a transition coming with some of these new devices. And so we wanted to get ready and start to hear about it today. The early access program for that will be available early next year. And so it's something that you should be aware of. There's obviously a lot of great things you can do today, both with our technologies and cross-platform frameworks, but we're just kind of giving you a heads up. So just to reiterate that, what I just said. So today, some wonderful stuff you can do with WebOS 2.0. We have a great new operating system, great new technologies, all kinds of ways to exploit new features and capability on the platform. You should consider, we think, using cross-platform tools because they solve some real problems for you, right? If you're looking at multiple platforms, some great solutions out there, rich experiences, some wonderful things you can do. Of course, you can also develop with a PDK today. Early next year, this is the heads up. You can get this new framework through an early access program next year. It's going to provide support for Enyo. It's going to provide support for different screen sizes. You can obviously continue with the PDK. You can continue with cross-platform frameworks. And then Mojo, like I said, is going to be a transition year for next year. So Mojo is going to continue to work for your applications, but we expect that it's not going to be optimal for all experiences, and that's why we're moving to this new framework, and that's the heads up that we're basically giving you today and at the program. Okay. So those are some of the details that I wanted to share with you. We have a great agenda set up for everyone, and I'm not going to take any more time because I think we're behind schedule. I am interested in some of the questions that were asked to Phil, Rick's question, and also the question about countries. So I can take some of that stuff in my marketing talk if you wanna hear that. I'm kind of bummed because I wanted to go hear Greg's talk. I didn't realize that I was heads ahead with Greg. So I'm sure he's going to give a great talk. But if you have some app questions, I could answer some questions at that time. Okay. So thank you very much, and have a great show.